Okay, now we will do this okay, let us just revise this one more time. I like to revise this. For example, what is the lease line? Lease line is a dedicated connection which is a permanent physical permanent circuit which is connected from your head office to branch office. This is circuit is only for you, so it has full security. Nobody can see data what you're sending and receiving. It's 24/7 uptime. The protocols are SDLC and PPP. The problem with this is it's very costly solution because the whole circuit is only for you. The second method, second type of WAN connections are circuit switching lines, which is online bandwidth, on-demand bandwidth, meaning it will create a switched virtual circuit. It will create a switched virtual circuit. And switched virtual circuit means it will, whenever you connect, whenever you, for example, you go to the your wireless modem is there, no, you connect by USB modem. You connect USB modem and you press connect, then it will connect. Or in mobile, you just press this data button, then it will connect. These all are called on-demand. Whenever you want, you can connect to the internet, connect to the WAN connection. So when you are connected to the WAN connection, it will create a circuit. Circuit is not permanent. It's not physical also. It is like virtually they create. Whenever you want, you will create and it can be switched also. Meaning, first time I can take circuit 1, second time circuit 2, third time circuit 3, like that I can change the circuits. That's why we call switched virtual circuit. Then, this circuit, when you join, depends on the that circuit bandwidth you will get. It's not permanently, we cannot give guarantee. This is the bandwidth it gets, so there is no guarantee in the bandwidth. Protocols are ISDN and dial-up modems. And it's a very cheap connection, but the problem is it's no guarantee, so we can use only for backup. This is circuit switching lines. A third type of lines are packet switching lines. Here, they want cheap connection, but they want the features of lease line. So they have created a third method that is called shared bandwidth. The meaning is, now I will give you a physical, not physical connection, virtual circuit, but permanent, like lease line. And that circuit, which is given to you, is one nobody can see the data. That service power level agreements, data protection SLA, I will give you. Okay, I will make sure that is what I will say. I will make sure that nobody can see your data. It's 24/7 uptime. These protocols are extra 25 ATM, frame relay, MPLS. So nowadays, mainly what we use is banks, government sectors use lease line. Rest all people use MPLS. MPLS is the cost-wise moderate and it is very good. So every company will have MPLS connection now. If you go to any company, work in the company, their WAN connection will be MPLS. Now, till now, what we studied is, it is called intranet and extranet. Intranet, extranet means between our same branches we have connected. It's not a public network, it's a private WAN. It's not a public WAN, it's a private WAN. The next type of circuit, next type of networks or technologies are, or types are, type is for your public network, that is your internet. What is internet? Internet is www, World Wide Web. Okay, it's worldwide, they have created, put wires, and whoever connect to the web, right, they are in internet. Now, as a customer, I want to connect to the web or www, internet. There are different types of service providers are there. Broadband service provider is there, for example, Airtel. They use protocols like DSL, ADSL, VDSL technologies. And the ACNET is there. This service provider uses Metro Ethernet. Reliance is there. They use WiMAX, 3G, 4G, 5G to connect to the network. And some old service providers are there, telephone service providers. Plain old telephone systems. They will connect through that port also, they can connect to the internet. Then some high service providers are there. They use SATCOM, satellite communications, VSAT, fiber, through that they connect to the internet. So these all are different technologies we connect to the internet. And remember, internet is a public network, it's not a private network. Now we are going to study mainly lease lines protocols in CCNA. So in CCNA, we'll be studying like what is SDLC, PPP, PPP, what is PAP, CHAP, MLPPP, and the PPP only. these are the protocols we'll study in CCNA. This is like that PPPoE, right? That is theory. Or we say client side. Only we'll understand client side. There is no lab mainly. In CCNP level, what we do, we will study two protocols. One is PPPoE full lab. We both server and client side will understand. That is CCNP level we'll do. Okay, then they will teach you the pre-successor of MPLS, that is frame relay. So frame relay will be discussed in NP level. Then in CCIE level, we will study MPLS. So MPLS is CCIE level, that is that now existing, now what is going on is MPLS. But MPLS will not directly study, we will go in this order. Now what I am going to teach you is, first, what is the difference between PAP and CHAP, or sorry, SGLC and PPP. Then in the PPP, we are going to study so many other technologies. In the PPP, there are so many flavors are there. We can say like PPP protocols we are going to study. Okay, first, let us start from what is, let me open one presentation. I think yesterday we have done that. Let me download the same thing. Now what we are going to study is, we are going to understand the, what protocols are running in this different things. So first thing I told you, in the LAN, if these two routers R1 and R2, this is WAN connection, serial connection, R1 and R2 are Cisco devices, okay. By default, without we are configuring anything, by default, it will be having a protocol called SGLC. SGLC is the Cisco proprietary protocol for serial connections. Okay. Now, how to see this, what protocol is running? The command is, you go here, show privilege mode you give. Show interface serial 0/0/0 if you give. Okay, you have to check there, in that you have to check encapsulation is what? Encapsulation is SGLC. Now by default it will be that we don't need to configure anything. You can use show command, you can see that encapsulation is SGLC. Now think like this, this side is this R1 is Cisco, R2 is something else, for example D-Link router. Now we cannot use SGLC is only for Cisco devices. It's a Cisco proprietary protocol, so we cannot use for any other Cisco proprietary protocol. We cannot use this protocol for any other device, any other vendors. So then if it is different Cisco and D-Link, then we have to go for open standard protocol. The open standard protocol is serial WAN serial protocol is called PPP, means point to point protocol. So this is a, it's a, not one protocol, it's a suite, protocol suite. Protocol suite means it has multiple, it has multiple, what do you say, multiple protocols as a family. You can call as a family of protocols, like we say Ambani family, right? Like that, family of protocols. Ambani has so many families, so many, the name is Ambani family, like that. PPP family, family of protocols. So in that family we are going to study so many protocols now. So let us take some protocol. First we are going to study in this family authentication protocols. So if PPP, in PPP what we can do, we can put passwords. For example, R1 and R2, I can put password. Username is R2. Password like this. Now if R2 is coming, right, it has to have this password, then only he will able to connect to the WAN link, will come up. This WAN link will come up. Okay, this is only available in, not in SDLC, it is in PPP. Okay, same thing I have to do here also. Username is R1 and password is N. When you configure both sides like this, then only your WAN link will come up. This is called authentication protocol. This authentication protocol has multiple flavors. There are three flavors for that I'm going to teach you. In our syllabus, you have two flavors. One is PAP. PAP is called what? PAP means point to point protocol. Sorry, PAP means not point to point. Sorry, I'm writing wrong. PAP is plain text protocol. CHAP means Challenge Handshake Authentication Protocol. These are the two authentication protocols. So what is the difference between plain text and the challenge access authentication protocol? So I will explain you this in the next slide. Okay, now what we discussed is different types of protocols. We are going to understand now. We are actually learning first two protocols, which is PAP and CHAP. So till now any doubt is there? If any, everybody is clear, just give yes, then we'll go to next. I'll go and configure and show you what is this PAP and CHAP. I'll configure and show you. Aisha said yes. Kausia, okay, yes.
Yes, sir.
Okay, Shiva also said yes. Okay, so let us first understand what is the difference between PAP and CHAP. Okay, now let us take two routers. They both are connecting through internet, a WAN connection. Now I don't know the other side router is my genuine router or a hack router. I don't know. How do I confirm it, the other side router? Okay, other side router is a genuine router. So how do I confirm it? So I will make one security countermeasure, a security control that is called, I will create a username and password. Now think like this is my internet. Okay, now I'm connecting here R1, R2. Okay, instead of internet, I'll just put here WAN service provider network. Let me put like this, WAN service provider network. That is the right word. Okay, now it may be internet or internet, whatever it is, internet. Now I'm connecting these two routers, but I want to confirm it. This is the real router, R2. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to create a username here, R2. R1 may R2 I'll put. Then I'll say password is Cisco. Same scenario, I'll create other side also. I'll create username and password that side also. And I will configure this side. This serial interface is there now. Here, I will configure PAP. Need to have PAP. In the PAP or in the PPP, so first I have to make it PPP. Okay. So both must be PPP. Sorry. In the PPP, I need to configure PAP or CHAP. Let us first teach you what is PAP. PAP is Plain Text Authentication Protocol. Here, what R1 will do, once you configure PAP here, what R1 will do, R1 will send a plain text, like for example, you say username is R1 and password is Cisco. R1 will send to R2. Now R2 will check that it has to be R1. R2 will check that the username and password is available in his database usernames. Then it is there, he will allow that in that, it will make that link up. Otherwise, your WAN link will be down, WAN protocol will be down. Okay. Now, this is called WAN, PAP. PAP means what? Plain text. Now it is sending as a plain text protocol. It's a plain text communication. Okay. Now the problem is, when there is a hacker is there, when he download this, right? He will able to see the username and password because it's a plain text communication. He may put that and he may connect to our network. So that I don't want to happen. Next, I'm going for CHAP. CHAP means challenge protocol. Here, what will happen? He will not send the username password as a plain text like this. What he does is, router will do is, in the CHAP, what he does is, it will take the username and password and he will create something called a encrypted text. He will encode to a encrypted text. This encrypted text is called a hash code. Now, this hash code is created by using the username and password, and it is sent to, now the traffic, what the packet is, what it is going is, from R1 to R2 is hash code. It's not a username password. It's just sending a hash code. Hash code is going. Now, the other side, what it does is, he will also take the username and password. He will also generate the hash code. Okay. Whatever hash code he receives here, right? He will also take that hash code. This is received hash code. Whatever he received from the other side, router. Receive hash code. Okay. Then he will compare. He will match both hash codes. So once you match this, if it is success, right? This is success, the link will come up. Fail, the link will not come up. Now, if a hacker is there, is trying to hack, he will only see the encrypted text. He cannot, he don't know the, he don't have the username password. So he will not find username password. He will get only encrypted text. Okay, this is the next method, challenge handshake authentication. So what is the challenge here? Whenever the R2 receives the R1 hash code, he has to create the hash code from his username password and see that both hash codes are matching. So this is the challenge it is giving. When the challenge is success, the link will come up. Otherwise, the link will not come up. This is called a challenge handshake authentication protocol. So this is compared to plain text authentication protocol, CHAP is more secure. So understand this. Any doubt in this PAP chat? If you are clear, give yes. Aisha said yes, no problem. What about others? Oh, she also okay, yes?
Yes, sir.
Shiva also okay. Okay, so now we have understood PAP-CHAP. Now, after that, I'll teach you the theory of MLPPP and PPPoE. That I will finish this lab and then we'll start that. So we'll start the lab first, PAP-CHAP lab. I'll open the GRIP lab. Yes, I've said yes. Now what I'm going to do, I'm going to show you how the WAN connections are configured. This our this one PAP-CHAP is configured, or CHAP is not PAP, CHAP is configured. I'll show you only CHAP. First of all, we need to find out what is the interfaces, or what is the encapsulation is happening in R1 and R2. So to do that, we'll go to the interfaces and see. Show interface fast Ethernet 0/0. So it will show me what interface. The interface is encapsulated with ARPA. ARPA is nothing but Advanced Research Project Agency, which is Ethernet version 2 name given by Cisco. ARPA means Ethernet version 2. Honored. They honored that Ethernet version 2 with a name called Advanced Research Project Agency. This is the organization who developed the internet. First, the internet was called ARPANET. So this is the organization they developed. So to honor that, they just give the name for internet, Ethernet. So ARPA means Ethernet version 2. Next, I will give interface serial we'll check. 0/0/0. Here encapsulation is SGLC. As I told you, by default, all routers will have SGLC, Cisco routers. Now I'm going to change the protocol from SGLC to, how to change it? I'll go to the interface first, interface serial 0/0/0. And I want to know what all the technologies it can support, L2 protocol, encapsulation, question mark. Now, this router R2 supports three protocols, SGLC, PPP, frame relay. Now I'm going to change this to PPP. The moment I change R2 to BPP, the line protocol will go down. You can see that line protocol is down, but status will be up. See, I'll show you the status. Show IP interface brief. You can see that status is up, meaning what? Status means L1. Cable and connector is working fine. I'm getting the electrical signal, no problem. But L2, protocol is L2. Where L2 is mismatched, that's why you say down. So physical layer is okay, data link layer is having some problem. Okay, now what to do? I will go to R1 and I will correct that issue. There also I will change this to I will give encapsulation. Then link will come up. Now see, the line protocol become up. Okay. Now this is what we did, we moved both sides SGLC to PPP, R1 and R2. Next, I'm going to create users. So user, first user is R2. R1 user is R2, password is Cisco. Same way R2 also will create user. Global mode, user is R1 and password is Cisco. We have to be very careful with the host name. Your host name will become username here, right? So host name must be properly configured, otherwise it will not work. Next, user is created. Then I will go to the interface and say serial PPP authentication. Now see question mark. Two options are coming. Challenge handshake authentication protocol, password authentication protocol. I'm going to select CHAP. CHAP is better than PAP. So CHAP I selected. The link went down and again came up. If there is no password configured in R2, it will never come up. Same way, we'll try in R2 also. I will go to interface serial 00000 PPP authentication CHAP. The link will go down. Other say username password is configured, so it will come up. Yes, came up. So PAP and CHAP. Okay. Any doubt in this? If it is no doubt, give yes. Then we'll go to MLPPP and PPPOE. Give yes, then we'll start MLPPPPOE. Aisha said yes, Saif said yes.
Yes, sir.
Okay, Shiva also yes. Okay. Gaushi also yes. Now, next topic I'm going to teach you is MLPPP. Now, if you remember, what is Ether channel? Okay, can you everybody answer what is Ether channel? Ether channel, can you answer in the Skype? What is Ether channel? As one to increase bandwidth, group of WLANs, group of WLANs. Gaussia is saying group of WLANs. What about Saif and Shiva? Sorry, it is VLAN. VLAN is WLAN. Okay, I think I'll learn from VLAN. Group of VLANs to increase bandwidth. Group of VLANs. Why VLAN and VLAN both are saying? Some confusion. Okay. The answer is, I saw a little bit near, but I need more clarity on that. Okay, let me give the answer for you. The answer is, what is Ether channel? So if anybody asks what is Ether channel? It is bundling technology, which is bundling Ethernet ports. To increase uplink bandwidth. This is the right words, and use that. Maybe you are knowing it, maybe not using the right words. Okay. And what it does, it creates something called, it creates a virtual interface, called the port channel 1. This is the virtual interface. Or we say VO1. Okay, So it will create a virtual interface called port channel 1, that is POA1. But that port channel 1, if you go and see show port channel 1, if you give, you can get the more bandwidth. So what we are doing, we are bundling Ethernet ports and we are increasing the bandwidth between two switches. Or we can say uplink, between the increasing the bandwidth of uplink. Now this is Ether channel. Now what is MLPPP? This is our today's topic. MLPPP is multi-link PPP. What is multi-link? Multi-link PPP is same like this, bundling WAN interfaces or WAN interfaces. WAN links we say, right? What is WAN link? Two router is there, I want more bandwidth. What I will do, I'll connect two WAN connections, then I'll bundle the two WAN connections to single WAN connection. Then that will create a what? It will create a virtual interface. What is the virtual interface will create? The virtual interface is called a, here, multi-link interface, that's it. The name of the interface is multi-link. So this is something like this. So I'll show you here commands. You can try in GNS3. Okay. See now, what I did here, I have just created a, taken two WAN connections and I bundled it. 200 Mbps, 1 Mbps, I bundled it. Now I'll create a new WAN link, WAN interface, that is multi-link. If I give this command show PPP multi-link, it will show me 2 Mbps. Ether channel in WAN is called MLPPP. LAN we call this as Ether channel. WAN what we call? WAN interface is what we call? Multi-link, multi-point or MLPPP. Multi-link PP. Okay, you're able to understand what is MLPPP? We are bundling WAN interfaces and increasing the bandwidth between two routers. Okay, Aisha is clear. Anybody has any other doubts?
No, sir.
Okay, yeah. Okay, next we'll go to PPPoE. The next protocol we are going to study today is PPPoE. PPPoE means point to point over Ethernet. First of all, remember, Ethernet is a WAN. Let me write down like this. Ethernet is a WAN protocol. Let me draw one packet for you, you'll understand. Now there is a data, this is called a frame, Ethernet frame format. In that format, we'll have so many details, so many things will be there. First we'll put a L4 header, then we'll have L3 header, then we have a L2 header. Then we have data. Okay. Now this is my, so this is like right out here, L4 header. So what is L4 protocol? For example, what will be there in L4 header? It will have something like a source port, destination port will be there. L3 header will be source IP, destination IP will be there. And L2 header will be, will have like this. These other information should be there. Source port, destination port, source IP, destination IP, source MAC, destination MAC. These other information should be there. Now, this is the data. The data size will be MTU, will say maximum transmit unit is 1500 bytes. The general one Ethernet frame, maximum 1500 bytes data we can send it in one frame, Ethernet frame. Now this Ethernet is a LAN. Now this LAN cable I want to use in your home, right? You will get a WAN connection, your broadband connection, but the cable will be connected is a Ethernet cable. If you go and check that, it will be RJ45 connector. So Ethernet cable I want to use for WAN. So what they did, they added in between, in this header format, they added extra 8 bytes here. That is PPPP header. This is our PPP. So whatever PPP header will be there, WAN details will be there. WAN related details will be there. But when I add this PPP header is 8 bytes. Okay. Now, I can, where I will put this, where I will, what do you say? These all are like 20 bytes like this. So this is 20 bytes, 20 bytes like that. But where I'll manage that, so what I did, I reduced this into this, the MTU. They made it 1492, the size they reduced it. So in the data size, they have reduced the MTU from 1500 bytes to 1492. And that 8 bytes they have taken for inserting the PPP header in the Ethernet frame format. So this becomes my PPPoE. PPPoE means what? Point to point protocol, or PPP over Ethernet frame. So now what I can do, I can use Ethernet technology like cables, RJ45 and a UTP cable, and I can connect to the computer, my modem, my router. So broadband router, if you see, they'll be using Ethernet cable. But inside the Ethernet packet, we are actually sending the WAN protocol, that is PPP. So we are using WAN protocol over Ethernet technology. That is called a PPP over Ethernet. Now, how they will do it in the broadband connection, if you see, there will be a service provider like this. You will be having a PPP server. PPPoE server. Okay. In that server, you will be having a lot of usernames, passwords, all these things will be there. Okay. And it will be connected to his ISP network, WAN, ISP WAN. Now I am a customer. I am going to connect my PC. Okay, my PC is connected to a router, my broadband router. My broadband router is my PPP client. So this router will be connected to a one small box. From that box, no, or you can say like this. Connected to your box here at the front. From that box, one will go to, you are seeing that, one will go to telephone. This is my telephone. Okay. Right. So one will go to telephone and one will go to router. This is the extension bar, splitter box we say. Splitter. Your broadband, in Airtel broadband, if you have, you can see that. So one will go to phone, one will go to splitter. The splitter box will split you the data and voice. Okay. Now from this broadband router, connected to my PC. Okay, let me connect to the PC. PC one. Now this is this split from the splitter box, it will be connected to the network through your WAN connection. Okay. Understand this. Now what I'm going to do you, I'm going to explain you how it works. So this is my router R1, I'll mention, right? This R1 is my PPPoE client. If you remember this DHCP process, DORA process, discover, offer, request, request and acknowledgement. If you know, then the same method is followed here also. Whenever you power on this router, what happens? Power on this router. Power on. First step. Do something called discovery. Discovery stage. Second step is session stage. right word? Session stage, or what is the word? Mistake here. Okay. Yeah, discovery stage, session stage, correct. Then we will first what will happen? It will send a discover packet that is called PADI. The names I'll write down. You remember this PADI. PADI means it is sending a discover packet. It is asking him, anybody is having PPP server is there? Can you give me any offer? Now next PADI is send. It is sending a. It will receive a PADO. PADO means offer. Offer you will get. O means offer. Form you see PPPOE active discovery. This is PPPOE active discovery initialization packet. Sorry, PADI is initialization. Okay, that's why we say PADI. Basically, it is sending a discover packet. Compare with DORA, no? It is sending a discover packet. Anybody is there? Can you start the class like that? First step. Second, you are getting an offer. Now, third, what it is doing? You will get a. Once you get the offer right from the PPPOE server, you will request PADOR. PADOR, that is a request. Now, then he will give one session details. PADS. What it does, it just start the session details. Correct, session configuration. Session configuration will send. Okay, now you can start the session he gives. Once you give the session details, then what will happen? Last step is, he will disconnect, terminate PADI. PADI means, he will terminate the discovery state. Discovery stage is end. Now the session stage starts. To do this to happen, right, it will be blinking for a lot of time. If you see that, when you power on that broadband router, no, it will take a lot of time to come up. That will be, it actually is running all the stages, PADI, PADO, PADOR, PADS, PATI. It is running, then the session stage starts. Then the, if you see that the internet light will start blinking. So if you next time when you see, you will understand actually why it is taking so much time to come up. So this PADO, PADI, PADOR, PADI, PADO, PADOR, PADS and PATI will happen. Then the session starts. So this is the client side. What we are discussing here? Client side, how the broadband router. This is client, this is server, right? PPP client. So client side, how the router comes. This is discussed in CCNA level. In CCNP level, we will actually configure this whole topology. Server as well as client will configure and we see that. That is CCNP level. So we do it in CCNP, that lab. Okay. So anybody has doubts in this? What is PPPOE? If you are clear, give yes. Any doubts, ask me. Then I'll go to next topic. I said yes.
Yes, sir.
You are also okay. Course also clear. Okay.
Sir.
Yes.
Sir, I'm not clear in this stages or discovery stages.
But it's not clear?
No,
but it's not clear.
Can you explain once?
This one,
sir, this PADI, PADO.
Okay, I'll explain you.
Yeah.
So, Saif asked, let me explain. I'll make it a small talk. Here, I'll make it a simple server. PPP. This is a broadband router, which is PPP client. Now, when you power on this PPP router, broadband router, first, what happens? First, your PPP client, the router, will send one PADI. PADI means PPP Active Discovery Initiation Packet. The first packet is, this is called packet walk. What we are going to see is packet walk. Okay, now what happens first? First, when you power on, so you are giving power on here, when you power on this client, first client, what he will send? He will send a initiation packet, like discovery packet. It is asking anybody is having any offer, can you give me any offer? He is asking, initiating the offer. He is asking, anybody is having any PPPoE server is there, can you give me the offer, like that. Now, PPPoE server will say, oh, okay, you are the new client, I'll give the offer. That is PADO. PADO means PPPoE Active Discovery Offer Packet. PPPoE Active Discovery Offer Packet. So he's giving an offer. So once you get the offer, what client will do is, okay, now he got the offer, right? He will request, sir, I got the offer, shall I use the offer? He will request. He said, I got the offer, shall I use that offer? And that is called PADR. He's going to say PADR. PADR means what? He is asking, I got the offer, shall I use the offer? Now what this guy will say is, server will say is, okay, I will give you the session details. You can start it with this session details, like username, password, whatever you want. I'll give all the details to you with this PAD, yes. PADS. PADS means session configuration. He will give all the session details. Then what client will do is, client will terminate the discovery stage. PADT. PADT means what? He will finish the discovery. Discovery done now. So terminate discovery stage. Then after terminating discovery stage, he has the session details, right? Session info configuration he got, no? Config. Using this session configuration, the client will start the new session. So session starts. Can mention like this, session. Now the session, let me put like this. I don't want to put the arrow mark here. I'll remove the arrow mark for you. Like this. So what it does, discovery start, discovery stage completed or end, discovery end, and session starts. So to start the session, you need to have the session configuration that you already received from the server. So using the session configuration, you can start the new session. Client will start a new session. And internet connection will start working for you. This is the steps when you power on the client. Okay, are you clear on this? Any doubt now? So, okay, now he is clear. If anybody has any doubts, please ask me. I will clear it out. Then we will go to next topic. The next topic will be, okay, let me go back. Yeah, quality of service. Yes. I said yes. Okay, good. Everybody's clear. Next, quality of service, then network programmability, then VPN. I'll cover one by one. Last topic will be BGP. So there are four topics pending now. So these four topics are very, very big topics. Okay. Every topic is like, I can teach you 80 hours. One topic. I can take quality of service, can teach you 80 hours. VPN 80 hours, network programmability and automation network programmability 80 hours, like that. BGP is like an ocean, 120 hours I can teach. That much big topics. Now what they are trying to do here is, in CCNA level, they just want to give you the basic idea of what is quality of service, what is VPN, what is network program automation and network programmability, right? All this basic knowledge, what is BGP, the basic knowledge you need to gather now. So then whenever you go to company working, no, you must not say, I don't know what is QAS, I don't know what is VPN. You can't say that. So you at least know the what is the concept. Try to learn that. Okay, let's start one by one. First, I'm going to teach you what is quality of service. I'll show you one diagram. The diagram will clearly tell you. This diagram you can see is beautifully telling you what is quality of service. Quality of service is nothing but bandwidth management. How much bandwidth I will give to how much for the particular data. Now you see this diagram. There is two pipes. One pipe is quality of service is not applied. Another pipe is quality of service is applied. Now this pipe has three types of data: video data, general data, ongoing data. Okay. Now these three types of data, it is going inside the pipe. What is happening after some time? The general data users are more. Okay. They are going to use the whole bandwidth. Your video data and non-linear data are started losing their connections. Okay. So this is the danger in the corporate network. In corporate network, what happens? In the corporate network, what happens? We'll be having like this. For example, let us take one small topology. Yeah. Now there is a router. In this router, I'm going to send three types of data. Now think like this router. No quality of service is configured. What will happen? This cable is going connecting to something like going internet is going like this. Now there is no quality of service, so three types of data is coming. First is data. We say general data as a data, general data, then voice data. Voice means you are calling now IP phones. The type of voice inquiry, voice related data, and video. Video is you are doing video conferencing in your office. CEO is calling to a customer. Video conferencing is doing this type of data. Now, what is happening here is when the general data, browsing data is increasing, your WAN bandwidth is losing the connection of voice and video. Your phone is becoming very noisy. And the video is disconnecting again and again. Video conferencing is disconnecting again and again. So these are all problems you are facing. So you told your engineer, as a CEO, you told, I want a dedicated bandwidth for my video connection. Then what he did, he applied QoS rules. QoS rules in the router. Or you can say QoS policies. QoS policy. Okay. Now what will happen after applying QoS policy? For example, you have 4 MB. You have 4 MB bandwidth, WAN link. So what that policy says, first, this is my QoS policy. It depends on the company to company, it varies. Okay. It's not fixed one. I'm just giving you one. So for example, I'll say, 1 MB for VC. VC means video. 1 MB for video conferencing or 1 MB for video. Then 1 MB for voice. Okay, 2 MB for data. So this is my general configuration. Some places we are having a lot of video conferencing. Then we can make like this, no issues for data. This is the configuration. Once I configure this this policy is applied in this router, what will happen? Automatically, whatever data is coming, it will do a lot of processes and make sure that the bandwidth is properly used. So after we configure the QoS policy, the CEO is not facing the video conferencing issues. Before the applying video QoS policy, CEO was facing video conferencing issues. After applying it, he is smoothly working, video conference smoothly working. So what it does is, it actually makes sure that particular data, video packet is properly, bandwidth is allocated. Okay, that is called quality of service. So quality of service means bandwidth management. What is quality of service? QoS. Now, QoS means bandwidth management. Now, first question. When the packet comes to the router, first what router will do? Let us do like this. First, the packet is coming to the router. First router, what he will do? He will do something called classification. In the QoS, the first activity is classification. It will classify the packets. Then he will put one code for the DSCP, differentiate services code point. One code he will add for each and every packet. So after this classification, DSCP generated. Let me put DSCP here only. Okay, DSCP is generated for every packet. What it does is it will actually use our QoS policy. So based on this policy, QoS policy, okay, this code point is there, na? DSCP will be kept in profile or out of profile. Meaning, it is coming under which profile? Data, voice, video. It comes from which profile? It will keep it. After that policy, it will mark. You will say you are a voice packet, you are a video packet, you are a data packet. Like that, it will mark the packet. Once marking is done, then it will actually put it in a queue or schedule the packet. Scheduling will happen. See, the very important point is, if there is so much data is coming, general data, okay. What it does is it will put it in the queue. It will not actually increase the bandwidth too far data. Data is allowed is only 1 Mbps. For example, data is getting 2 Mbps data is coming. What he will do, router will do is, he will tell you, wait, I can send you only 1 MB. So your limit is only 1 MB, you wait. I will schedule you for after 2 minutes, I'll send you once this 1 MB is finished. Like that, it will queue and schedule the next, that is by done by buffer. Something called buffering will be there. Using buffers will do it. Buffers, it will buffer, it will do it. Buffer means it's a temporary memory. Using buffer, it will do it. So this process is going to happen, means then automatically your data is properly managed and your voice and video will be never have any quality issues. Clear on this? So this is called what? QoS. Okay. Ask me now if you have any doubts. Otherwise, I'll go to next topic. What is QoS? Can give yes if you understood. So Kumar said yes. Aisha, okay. Saif, okay. Gosia? Gosia is there, right? Fine, all said yes. Now what we understood in QoS, I'll show you the presentation now. So what we understood in QoS, whenever a data comes to the QoS enabled device, it will actually classify the data, generate the code point, differentiate services code point. Then it will, based on the policy, it will put in and out profile and mark the data, voice or video, whatever. Like they generally use platinum, gold, like that. They will mark it, whichever it is, based on the DSCP. After that, it will shape the packet and put it in the queue. Shaping means, for example, you see that YouTube, no? You can select that 240, 480. That is actually shaping the video. How much pixels you want. Like that, you can shape the voice quality, you can shape the video quality, you can shape like that. That is shaping, we say. So based on that, you will shape and you will put it in the queue. So the queue will be like a buffer. Whenever you want, it will be sent it. So there are different ways to queue it. Like weights are there, so many methods are there. That all we'll study in the QoS class. QoS detailed discussion will come in CCIE level. Now you see the example here. There's a phone here, it is going to R1, R2, R3, another phone. So if there is no QoS, the phone communication will be very bad. QoS enabled, phone communication will be very good. Okay. Now, there is one more point they are discussing here, is device trust. A very, very important thing is, I need to know which devices will be trustable device. Or we call it as trust boundary. Example, I can say my trust boundary is from this to this. apart out from this, somebody is connected in outside of this and they say like, boss, your quality is not good, then you say them, see, my trust boundary is only from this router to this router only. I only configure QoS only to this router, this router. If you go and connect to another router and say, this router, you are not getting good quality of service. Sorry, sir, that is not under our trust boundary. So we have to be very clear with the customer saying that, see, your office to office, you can do video conferencing. There'll be no problem. But if you do from home, home devices are not trust devices. So that may have some video issues. So please come to your office and any one of your office you come and use any one of your VC systems to do video conferencing, then you'll not face the any problem. As worst case scenario, you can go for your home, try from mobile. That is okay. But best case scenario is there. So they have to know that what is the device trust, what is the trust boundary, then only there will be no problem. Otherwise, they may not know that. It feels like everywhere it will work properly, it will not work like that. So we have to configure the all the devices, not one device. Even one device is not working, also problem. See, I put QoS. Everywhere, QoS has to be configured, right? All devices. One device miss also, the device is not trusted, then it is gone, it will not work. So understand this, QoS mechanism. Okay, next we'll go to, next topic is VPN. Okay, we'll give yes for VPN, everybody. We'll start VPN. I'll ask some questions in VPN. Give yes, I'll ask some questions. Okay, now we are going to study next topic, VPN. VPN means virtual private network. So there's a question for you. What are the two technologies we use to create virtual private network in a public network? Let me write down the question for you if you feel like. What are the two technologies? Main technologies, I can say. Two main technologies we use to make virtual private network. Create virtual private network. Network in a public network. Example, public network is internet. The public network is internet. So when I'm coming in internet, when I'm going through internet, I like to secure my network data. So example is I'm going through internet, I want to secure the data. So what are the two technologies, main technologies I'll use to virtually create a private network? How to do, what are the two main technologies? Anybody can answer that? What are the two main technologies we use to create a virtual private network in a public network? Technologies, WAN is a network. I'm asking, see, internet is a WAN. What my question is, what are the two main technologies? You don't know, okay. Aisha don't know. And what about these guys, Kaushi and Saif? Kaushi also don't know. Saif? You also don't know. What here? Okay, let us start then. I have to start from the basics. Now, consider this as my server, VPN server, or like let us tell you this server, S1. I am a user. I want to connect to this server. So from home, right? I'm a remote user, a home user. I'm working from home. And I'm working from home, right? I cannot get an internet connection, like a private connection. So I'll come through my internet. So what I will do, I will just take my PC. I will actually connect the VPN client software. I'll connect it. Then I will work. Actually, what is happening that time? This is a physically public network. Remember, internet is a physically public network. Anybody can see. For example, there is a hacker. He can come and see. So this is my hacker. the hacker. Okay, so this hacker, no, he can come and see whatever I'm sending and receiving. So how do I protect from this hacker? So what I will do, I will actually create here, I will implement two technologies with my same data. First, what I will do, let me write down here. Okay, let me draw the diagram here. Think like this, there is a data available. Okay, this is my data. I want to secure the data. So first thing what I'm doing, I am going to put a huge encapsulation, huge header, big header, like this, huge header. This is my what it will happen is, if a hacker wants to see the data, what he need to do is, he need to break this header first. So breaking this header and coming and seeing the data is here, it will take a lot of effort. So hacker cannot touch the data without breaking this header. This header is called a generic routing encapsulation header. So this process of adding a huge header, encapsulating huge header, encapsulating, adding information, huge header, this is called what? Tunneling. So what do you mean by this? This is nothing but tunneling. So what we did tunneling? I tunneled my data with a huge header. Now hacker want to see the data, he has to break this tunnel or break this header. So breaking the header is a huge task. First technology. The next technology what I did, I'm not satisfied with only tunneling. Even if anybody comes and see that, even they break the tunnel or break the header, they come and see, the data is actually not a plain text. It is a cipher text. It is encrypted. Cipher text. Meaning what? Encryption. So first technology what I applied is tunneling. The second technology what I applied is, So when I do this two, technologies, what I am doing here, I am actually sending in the same public network. Actually, see, internet is what? Internet is physically public network. Right. So in this public network, I am going to add two technologies with my data. For example, this is my data. With the data plus I'm going to tunnel plus I'm doing encryption. Now what will happen? Though physically I'm sending in a public network, virtually it becomes what? It becomes private network. Virtually, physically it's a public network, I'm not changing it, but virtually it will become a private network. So what is VPN? VPN is nothing but the data is physically going in a public network like internet, but using these technologies, we are making that virtually private network. So nobody can see the data like that, virtually private network. So this is a huge concept nowadays. Nowadays, in future and nowadays, we are actually using this internet for sending and receiving data. So understand what is VPN? Any doubt? If you are clear, give yes, then I'll tell you types of VPN. So VPN means, okay, I think everybody's clear now. Good. Everybody's clear. Very good. Next, we'll see types of VPN. Now, when you see types of VPN, there are three types of VPN is there. We are going, that's how many types of VPN is there? We are going to discuss three types of VPN. That's it. I cannot say three types of VPN. So let us take three types of VPN. So VPN types. First type is called a site. So that is knowing that. Remote access, not client to site. remote access, or you can say client to site if you want. Third is DMVPN. Now, site to site means it is basically from head office, HO router to branch office router, BOL router, meaning router to router. It's nothing like no devices, no end devices. Here what happens, we'll be having a VPN server to client, like PC, which is a VPN client PC, client laptop or PC. So this is something like remote access means server to client. So you have to install the client software in your PC, laptop. Then DMVPN means dynamic multipoint VPN. So what is the dynamic multipoint? I'll tell you. Dynamic multipoint VPN. Here what happens? Here automatically the VPN tunnel will be established. Backup tunnel. Automatically established. You can say like backup tunnel established. So now backup tunnel means what? When a primary fails, automatically your backup tunnel will be established in the DMVPN. So how it does is, it actually maintains one hub and spoke concept, and it will keep all the details in the one router. So whenever one router fails, no, they will use that details and they will themselves will fire the tunnel. Fire means configure the tunnel automatically. We don't need to manually configure. So this is called DMVPN. So first site to site, which is between head office router to branch office router. Remote access VPN, which is connecting from your working from home, right? Working from home is remote access VPN. Okay, so here what we do, we actually have a VPN client software in your laptop. We have to go and just use that laptop for connecting it. This is remote access VPN. Then we have a DMVPN, DMVPN dynamic multipoint VPN. A backup tunnel will be established automatically. So these are the three types of VPN. Now let us see what is covered here.
Sir.
Yeah, tell me.
Hello.
Yeah, tell me.
Sir, site to site is not required any software, sir.
Software is not, there is no client software. You have to go to the router and router you have to configure directly. Router or firewall, you can just create the tunnel.
Okay.
It's nothing like there is no PC involved, a laptop involved. In between firewall to firewall, router to router, like that.
Okay.
That is site to site VPN. Here in remote access VPN, there will be one server, VPN server, VPN concentrator, we say. There is a box called VPN concentrator or a server. Then every laptop will have a client software. The client software will be installed in every laptop. Then you need to, when you need to connect to the server. That is called remote access VPN. Clear? Yeah, Sukumar said okay. Then anybody have any
questions? So can you practically show how we can access VPN through our laptops?
Practically showing CCNA security.
Okay.
We need to build that VPN concentrator first. Just I'll show you the diagram. You want to just see the diagram, right? How it will be like, right?
Yeah.
Just one client software you want to see, right?
Yeah, so I mean practically how we can implement it.
I'll just show you now. See, there is a Cisco AnyConnect VPN client, okay? I'll download for you and show you. Just to see, right? I don't know if it's available to download.
Yes, sir.
I'll see in my desktop, I already have, because I don't have now. Okay. drive security, CCNA security softwares, DM launcher. No, no, I don't have that. Okay, let me see. We'll get some diagrams. I'll show you at least. Images. Yeah. See, now once you install this software, right, in your laptop, you will get one screen like this. When you right side, it will come. Okay. Then you need to go and give this domain name. They will give a domain name, their company, your company domain name. They'll give. Then you have to press this connect button. Understand? Once you press this connect button, they'll show you like tunnel establish will happen. Tunnel will establish. Then you will say you are secured. The message will come. Then you can start working in your company. Once you connect like this, you will get a whatever you do in your office, right? The same access you will get from home also. This is the software you have to install. Any client, this is one of the software, client software. You can download it and install. Okay, let me see. Can I download for you somewhere? In CCNA security class, we will be doing this lab. There is a lab for this. We will be doing this lab in CCNA security class. Here we don't do this. It's a routing and switching, right? Here we don't do that lab. There is a huge theory is there to understand this, no? There is a huge theory called the protocol what we use for this remote access VPN is SSL. And the protocol what we use, let me write down the name of the protocol. That all we have to study. Okay, in CCNA security, we will study that right on here. So site-to-site VPN, what protocol we use? The protocol is called IPsec, VPN protocols. This all comes in CCNA security topic. We need to build the topology. We need to build the lab. It's not easy, just like that, I cannot show you. Okay, if anybody, cannot show you. IPsec, this is SSL. Is it also possible? Let me put this aside. Remote access, no? I'll put here. SSL or TLS. These are the protocols for remote access. Okay, I'm downloading the presentation. This one, any client. Let's see, it is working now for me. Meanwhile, I'll show you some diagrams. Explain you. So you will have a like a message like this will come like this round one, then we'll get option here. You give the server VPN server IP address, then press connect. Then it will be connecting to your VPN server. But we must have a first VPN server to be configured first to do this. Once the VPN server is connected, then you'll get one IP address, whichever IP address you get in the office, the same IP address will get here in your home. Then you can start working as you're working from office. This is called a client installation. Server installation also there in the server side. That both will study in how to connect. Client is very simple. Just download the software, install in your laptop. Then that IP address will ask, IP address or domain name will ask. Give that IP address or domain name here and just connect here. Are you able to understand, Aisha?
Yes, sir.
It's very simple. Like just download the software. Mobility Connect software is there now. Then give that server IP address. The server IP address will be given from your company. Okay, so I'll show you the diagram here. This, there is a VPN concentrator is there. Can you see VPN server? That server IP address they'll give you. Some people will give IP address, public IP address. Some people will give the domain name if they are registered domain name. Then give the domain name in the client software. Then automatically you will be connected to this. Clear on this?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so now Let me see, this guy is downloading. Now what we do in our lab is, in our CCNA classes, site-to-site VPN, GRE tunneling will configure. Now we will configure and see, site-to-site tunneling, GRE, site-to-site VPN, GRE tunneling server. Remote access VPN is not in our lab, that is in CCNA security. Here what they show you is, how do you create a site-to-site tunnel between two routers? That they are going to do, we are going to do that. That lab is there in our syllabus. This is DMVPN. Let us give you some diagram. The red color is automatically getting configured. Gray color is statically configured. That is DMVPN. Okay. Now VPN, I told you, right? Huge header we are adding with the data. That is called tunneling. This is the GRE header. This is the data. To reach the data, you have to break the header first. Okay. Now, configuration is very, very simple. Just go to two routers. Configure the public IP, then create a virtual interface called tunnel 0, then give the public IP. If you don't configure the mode, the protocol will be generally like SGLC is the Cisco protocol, right? Same way, our VPN will have default protocol is GRE. Cisco's proprietary protocol is GRE. If you don't give also, it will be GRE. This side I didn't give, right? But it will be both, it will be GRE only. Then you tell the router, from which IP address or which interface the tunnel starts, source, and where it ends. Same way, another side also, from which interface the tunnel starts, which interface the tunnel ends. That's it. This is the configuration we are going to do in the routers. Then you can go and verify. Here we created a new tunnel. In the routing table, the tunnel interface will be added. Then in real time, you can ping. Once you are connected to the tunnel, you are connected to VPN, you can ping your private IP address. Remember, this is 192.168 is not allowed in internet, correct? But once your VPN is established, like for example, you're working from home, right? Once your VPN is established, you can ping your office private IP address from your home because it is going inside the tunnel. So it is going to the your data is going inside the tunnel. So outside it is going to use the public IP only. So private IP will not be visible to anybody. Understand this? Now let us try to do this lab. See how far we can go. I think it's downloaded now. Let's see if it's working. There we are. Extract. Let it install. Meanwhile, we'll do GNS3. The topology what we are going to use is two routers, that's it, R1 R2. we are going to do VPN. What we are trying to do here, we are going to configure tunnel. This side where we are going to configure. Okay. 100, 100. Then, to start. So first what we'll do, we'll write on the 63.1.1. Yes, it was here and so it was. Okay. Now what I'm going to do, I'm going to start the GNS3. We're going to do the VGA of VGS lab. We are going to create one tunnel 0 here. So we are going to create a virtual interface tunnel 0. And I will give the IP address IP will be 192. Any IP I can give, private IP, but 192.168.1.1.10.1. Then source will be starting from 63.tunnel source, from where tunnel starts, 1.1.1. end in the other side, in the router 2. Okay, this is the session here. This here also I'll create. I'll create one more. 0, the IP address will be 10.2. The source will be starting from 2 and ending to 1. That's it. Then protocol, if you want, if you don't configure any protocol, it will not take. Otherwise, you can configure the protocol like mode. Mode will be here. Don't configure also, it will not take. Okay, this is the configuration I'm going to do now. This is optional. If you don't give, it will be DRE only. Okay. You must reboot the system for the installation changes effective. See this now, Aisha?
Yes, sir.
There, here, this is your VPN. Here you configure that the public IP. For example, 200. They will give you, that company will give you 200.10.10.1 like this. Will give you. Then you have to press connect. Then what it will do? It will try to connect your VPN server. If the VPN server is there, it will ask username password. Then give username password. Then you will be connected. It will mention here connected. Okay. This is here.
Okay.
This is one way you connect. Now it's saying it's not available. Clear, na?
Yes, sir.
Okay, next we'll see how to configure site-to-site VPN, okay? Let us move back. Let us start the router first. Start the router. Now I am starting my routers. What is my memory power? Okay, started. Memory is no problem, CPU is no problem. Okay, let us start the consoles. No problem. Okay, so I have no problem in my CPU utilization. Memory is a little bit high, it's okay because I have running so many applications parallelly. I'll keep my router R1 and R2 so we can see both. Right, we are ready to configure. Now first we'll start, we'll create one small script so we can do not need to type everything. So let us go to R1. What is the script we'll build? Serial 1/0 IP address. Let me copy these guys. The tunnel you give. This is R1. Let me do R2. R2 will be one. Okay, everybody understand this? What I'm doing here? I'm actually creating a script, so we don't need to type each and everything one by one. So all are created in the script, so we can verify this after this done. So what we will do? We will just give end. So IP. Route one place, then we'll give this another side, we'll give end. IP interface brief, something like this. Are you understanding right what I'm doing? I'm just copying this script. I'm putting in my router. There are one. Okay, let us start. Now, first I copied R1, put it R1 here, paste, done, ready. Next, R2 I'll copy. Let's see. Done. Now both I will finished. Now what I will do, I will check this is working. First I will go with R2, enter. Now tunnel 0 is configured, but it is down. IP address is configured, it is down. Now here route, nothing is there. Why it is down? Because the interfaces is not up. See the serial interface, I didn't give no shutdown. The mistake what I did is I didn't give serial interface no shutdown. So I have to go to the serial interface and I have to give no shutdown. Yes, correct. I will give 1/0 no shut. Same way I'll do here also, then it will come up. 1/0 no shut. Now verify. Now still going on. Yes, what is this? Any other mistakes? Tunnel is up. Now we can see. Exit. So IP protocols. Yeah, so IP route. I got a tunnel route. Nice. Great. And here also interface. So IP interface brief. I got a tunnel interface. Both L1 and L2 is up. So this is the way you verify the tunnel is established. Now tunnel got established between two routers. Now what we can do, we can actually in real time, we can actually ping like this 192.168.10.2, it will ping. Here it looks like directly connecting, but in real time, it will be through internet, you can ping the private IP address. If you want to ping private IP address, you must have the VPN, otherwise private IP is not allowed in the internet. So through internet, we can ping private IP address. This is the final test. And what is the protocol now? Interface, show interface, tunnel 0. Okay, I want to see what protocol is running. Tunnel 0. Now here it will show me. What is the protocol running? See, protocol is GRE. Generic routing encapsulation. IP means IPv4. By IPv6 also. GRE, IPv4. Understand? Now I want to see what are the other protocols are available. I just want to know what are the WAN VPN tunnel protocols are available. How to see that? Go to the interface tunnel 0. Port. Yes, tunnel mode. See, these are the commands. These are the tunnel protocols. We used GRE by default, but there are so many other tunnel protocols are there. You can see that you have IPsec tunnel, we have MPLS tunnel, we have so many other types of tunnels are there. What we are using is GRE tunnel. That's it. So there's so many tunnel protocols. So the command is tunnel mode GRE question mark. See, DMVPN is coming. You are using IP, you want to use, you already use IP before or DMVPN. So I'm saying IP. So you're understanding this? Okay, you understood how to configure VPN? Site to site VPN, how to establish a tunnel? Okay, that's a very simple configuration. If you understand the theory, it's not difficult. Okay, next we'll go to network programmability. Now this is a advanced topic, which is going to come next year. Next year onwards, February 24th, 2020 onwards, Cisco is introducing new CCNA, with network programmability. Now, in our, now this syllabus doesn't have that much details. This syllabus doesn't have that much details, but in future, after 1 year, after 8 months, you must know this programmability very detailed level. Here they're just touching it and leaving it, but you must know very detailed. What is JSON scripting? What is Python? What is the Conf? So many protocols are there. That all you have to study. That will come in next year onwards. But as of now, I'm just telling you what is programmability, how it works, what is the basics of programmability we will discuss today. Okay, let us start. VGP, I don't know what I want to use. Programmability, where is programmability? Okay. I will put, what is it? So now what I'm going to teach you is network programmability. So what is network programmability is, nowadays what is happening, all are actually moving to automation. Automation means automatically getting configured, and a lot of scripting work is started. After this, what do you say, artificial intelligence, all machine learning came, no? These things started having, we call it as RPA. RPA means remote program automation, remotely programming automations. RPAs we say. So this RPA started for a long time back. Because of this RPA, what is happening? All the networking, all the devices is automatically getting configured. They want to configure automatically. They don't want any human intervention. So how to do that? That first we are going to understand what are the different types of softwares available, operating systems available in the Cisco. So which one will support network programmability, which one will not support. Okay, first thing. We have almost four types of softwares available or operating systems available in Cisco. iOS, iOS XE, iOS XR, iOS NexOS. Okay, iOS, and what is the difference between iOS? iOS is a basic software which we are studying now. In CCNA, we are studying iOS. But when you go to service provider level, you will be studying iOS XE and iOS XR. In service provider level, they will be teaching XE and XR. Then in data center, cloud, all these things, they use NexOS. NexOS is the data center operating system, which is developed by Cisco. So basically Cisco developed so many softwares. That is one of the main software is NexOS. And XR, XE is basically for service provider level, not for enterprise level. Okay, now you understand here, there are three types of network they generally classify. One is SOHO network, small office, home office network. Second is enterprise network, which is MNC company. Third is service provider networks. So service provider networks uses complex network technologies, advanced technologies. They use XR and XE. XR, XE means iOS, XR, iOS, XE operating systems. Generally, SOHO users are they using. So enterprise and SOHO, no, they use iOS operating system. Data center networks, virtualization networks, they use storage, SAN, all they use NexOS. Data center, storage, all they use NexOS. So now, programmability concept starts from XR. Okay, they are started from XR. So in XR, we'll do, there is a concept called flexible programmability for dynamic configurations. It's available. XR and NexOS supports programmability. Now, first, to understand programmability, first you have to understand what is SDN. Okay, tell me what is SDN. Let us see. What is SDN? Any answer? No answer? SDN. Is there? Just tell me yes or no, I don't know, I know, something like that. You can just reply no. Aisha, don't know. SDN. What is SDN? Shiva is typing something. Saif also typing something. Software defined network, correct. Correct answer. Shiva gave. Toshiya, don't know. Okay, so what is this SDN? SDN is nothing but, now future, we don't have hardware boxes. We'll be having only software devices. Router, software router. All will be software. See here, now what is happening? We have different devices, right? Which will be having one data plane. Then we have an operating system. Then a management or control plane. There are three planes. Every device will have a three planes. So this is all now current, today's network. Now these devices will have operating system and management load. We can connect and configure this, right? But future, what they do, they remove all these two planes, control plane and the network operating system, remove and make as a single device, that is controller. This controller, then the devices become dump devices. What we call this? Dump devices. So there is only data plane. There is no control plane or there is no operating system in the devices. So how do we connect that, configure that? Using a protocol called OpenFlow, we will manage all the devices. So this controller will be having all devices, operating system as well as management plane or control plane. So what we will do, we will build a script like how I did a small script now, right? Same way, they will build a script in Python or some other language. Then they will put that in the controller. Now what controller will do, within few minutes, it will configure all the devices. Because these devices are not actually available, the control plane is not there in these devices. The control plane is there in the controller, SDN controller. So what is SDN controller? The data, the control plane and the network OS, no? It is taken, extracted from all the devices, and the devices are just a dump devices. They don't have any, apart from data plane, nothing is there. So the whole control is coming in a single location, that is called controller. So what I will do, I will just put a script in the controller. Within few minutes, the whole network will be configured. This is called the programmability. So you're able to understand this, what I'm saying? Any questions? Let's see what you understood in this. Okay, you can ask me any questions, otherwise give yes, I'll go next. Okay. Boshi also understood, good. Isa, okay. So Kumar, it's clear? See, in future, we don't have any company, MNC, work in MNC company. It's not like that. In future, we will be having some other work. It's not like you don't do this. Server rooms will not be there. Server rooms, data centers, nothing, none, there will be nothing will be there. See, MNC company will be having actually. If you ask me, MNC, I'm working in a lot of MNC companies. I go to training, right? All MNC companies having data centers. They will not remove, they will have, but small companies are there, no? Like Soho companies, they will not have any devices. They have only dump devices. Big MNC company will have their own devices. And Cisco also, Cisco don't want to make completely SDN. Now, Cisco solution is a little bit different. Cisco's solution is something different. What they did is, they actually kept both this plane in the devices, but they created a controller also. For example, in the pure SDN, real SDN, controller fails, the whole network fails. But in Cisco SDN, controller fails, the devices will work. If you want, you can go to each and every device and you can configure. This is available. So what Cisco did is, Cisco created the same concept, but they left the control plane and data plane, control plane and OS in that. Okay, they kept the controller here. Now, what is the point here? If the controller fails, the devices will not going to die. The devices will have their own intelligence. It will be keep on working. Only you have to go to each and every device and configure now. We cannot configure in the central location. So that is the only problem if the controller fails. That is the approach Cisco is taking. So in future, all will be software devices. We're not having a physical devices available in a smaller company. Bigger company, they obviously will maintain their own data centers, small data centers. Enterprise data centers will be outsourced to cloud service providers. Enterprise means like a huge data center will be not will be there. Small data centers will be the local data center on-premises data centers will be there only for internal purpose. Huge data centers will be outsourced to service providers like cloud service providers like Microsoft, Google, Amazon. They will have that enterprise data centers. Small data centers will be there in MNC company. So this is the future. We don't know how far we will go. Let's see. Next, the last topic today, which you're going to complete the course, is BGP. So BGP, what is BGP? BGP is here, Border Gateway version 4 protocol. It's a standard-based open standard. This is RFC number. And this is the exterior gateway protocol which can work between two autonomous systems. This is the only protocol which will work between different autonomous systems. The STAL protocol work within autonomous system. Okay, autonomous system is something like a country. Country to country you want to go, you must go through visa process, right? But within the country you don't need to have visa process. Like that, same autonomous system if you work, it is called the interior gateway protocol. Different autonomous system if you want to travel is exterior gateway protocols. So only protocol which can go to two different autonomous systems, that is EBE, that is EGP, is only EGP is Border Gateway Protocol. This uses path vector. What is path vector? It will see that how many AS it has to cross. It is not going to see how many devices here. A RIP uses the distance vector. Distance vector means it will see how many devices it has to cross. But what BGP will see is how many AS you have to cross. That's it. We call it as path vector. And BGP is not only one parameter. It is going to use multiple attributes. It is having almost 10 attributes and can create its own policy also for selecting the best route. That's why BGP is a big topic. And it's a classes routing protocol, support VLSM and summarization. This autonomous system means what? They have mentioned here. Theory, what is okay. Now, same like public IP address, you are going and buying from IANA to register to service provider. Same way, autonomous system also, you have to go to service provider, means IANA, and buy from IANA. Okay, basically, they beginning they had only 2 bytes, like 0 to 65,000. Now they have the limit is finished, now extended to 4 bytes. Now 0.0 to 65,000 is the ASN number, autonomous system numbers. Okay, next, BGP is the one protocol which is no limit. It can take multiple billions of routes. It will not do anything. Thousands of routes, billions of routes we take. And now we have so many routes are available in the worldwide. Stability, it will never fail because no convergence happens. It will always be there in the maintain, and we can enforce routing. I told you routing policy, right? We can create each and every route. Okay, selecting the best route, we can create a policy on that. Okay, and which is 10 attributes are there, which is impossible to think in the IGP. IGP means RIP EHRP OSPF. RIP uses only one attribute, that is hop count. EHRP uses 5 attributes: bandwidth and delay, reliability, load, MTU. OSPF uses only one hop count. Only one, what is OSPF using? OSPF is using only one attribute, that is bandwidth. So RIP uses hop count, EHF uses 5 attributes, but BGP, OSPF uses only one attribute, bandwidth, but EAGRP 5. But maximum is what? BGP. BGP uses 10 attributes, which is nearly impossible to build the traffic engineering. So that's why BGP is very great, very good in selecting the best route. Okay, next. Who needs BGP? BGP will be only for service providers and multi-homing networks. Transit means service providers. Transit networks and multi-homing networks, they use BGP. Rest all don't need BGP. Okay, so what is multi-homing networks? Let me explain you that. Now I am a customer, I want to go to internet. Okay, so what happens generally when I am a, this is what is multi-homing. Okay, I am a enterprise network. Now I need to connect to my internet. So what I did, I bought one WAN connection. I connected. This is my switch. I've taken one router. And I have connected. Now, what is the configuration I'll do in the this router? What routing I'll do? In R1, this is going to my ISP. Remember, this is internet. ISP means internet service provider. So what configuration you will do here in the R1? Can anybody tell me? What routing I'll do in this router, my internet router? What routing I'll do? You know different types of routing? Tell me what are the types of routing we have. Static routing, dynamic routing. In static, different types of routings are there, no? What are the types of routing we have? We'll do dynamic routing? No. Because this is going to internet, right? So we cannot configure dynamic because we don't know what is the other side configured. So what we have to configure this side? Static routing. So what static routing will configure in R1? Anybody know static routing? No idea? Okay. Let me explain you, just draw the diagram explain. So what happens in internet is there are billions of routes are there. Okay. We cannot, our routers are there, no, company routers. We cannot actually hold that many routes in our router. Okay. To hold that, you must have minimum 1 GB RAM. Okay, then you must have a public IP. You have to pay money and buy public IP. Then you must have a ASN number. You have to pay money and buy ASN number. All these things, if you have only, you can actually keep all the routes. So instead of that, what we will do, we'll just sell this router. Just whoever wants to go wherever, please go to the ISP, default route to ISP. In house also, right? In home router is there, no, your house router. That also doesn't have all the routes. What they do in the house router also, they will just say wherever this customer wants to go, right? 0.0.0.0 they'll put and say ISP IP address, this router. There will be one ISP router will be there, right? This ISP router will have all the routes. This is the maintain all the internet routes. ISP router. Understand? So our router will have only default route. So the traffic will go from here like this. Whoever wants, for example, there is a person wants to go to internet, he will come here, then he will go to this router. From the router, he will go to this ISP. ISP will route it, then again send back to whatever data collected, send back to here. So this is called a single home. Now, what is multi-homing? Multi-homing means I want to send the traffic in R1. The traffic has to go in R1. Good. I like accept this. But after it goes to R1, I want to come back in R2. Traffic has to go like this. Go like this. Then I want to come back in R2. Like this. Is it possible now? Not possible in default routing. Then what we need to do? We need to go and buy one public IP. Your RAM must be more than 1 GB. Then buy one autonomous system number from ISP. Then configure, remove default route, configure BGP. Once you configure BGP in both routers, then what will happen? The traffic will come from R1, goes to service provider, then it will go. So you are also part of, your router is also part of internet. So that is called, this is called multi-homing. So what is multi-homing? Your traffic will go from one router, one service provider, the return traffic will come from another service provider. This is called multi-homing network. Understand this? If you want multi-homing network, then only you go for BGP. Otherwise, don't go for BGP. Just use stat default router. You understand? One, who will use BGP? First, service providers. They will use BGP. Okay, second is enterprise networks who want multi-homing. What is multi-homing? The traffic will go from one ISP, come from another ISP. Then that time I need a multi-homing, that time I need BGP. To configure BGP, what all things I want? My router must be minimum 1 GB RAM. I must have a public IP, then I must buy a public IP as well as an autonomous system number. Then only I can configure BGP. Okay, are you clear on this? Who will use BGP? Give yes, I'll go next. Aisha said yes. Saif, okay. Shukumar also yes. Okay, Gausia yes. Next, I'm going to show you. Same diagram they've given you. Going from one ISP, coming from another ISP. Next, when not to use BGP? If you have only single ISP, don't use BGP. Default routing is enough, I told you, right? So memory is less than 1 GB, don't use BGP. If you don't have any IP address, private public IP address, you don't have any BSN number, don't use BGP. Okay. Now, how to configure BGP? Enable BGP globally, then establish the neighborhood by a neighbor command. Just give neighbor IP address and what is the remote of the remote AS, what the neighbor say is. Like this, they have given some commands here, right? First, create neighbors. Neighbor we call peer here. Peers. Once peer is established, then advertise the route. Very important point here. Network command is not for adding interfaces. Network command is to advertise the routes. Very, very important. Network command is to advertise the route here. In BGP, network command is not for adding the interfaces. Here we will exactly say you advertise what networks I have advertised to my peer. I'm not sending any route updates, all routes. I'm not sending anything like that. BGP will not send any route updates. Whatever network command you give, that networks will be advertised to the peers. Peers means neighbors. Okay. Now after that is everybody receives that, then it will run like this. There will be three tables. First is peer table, which will call my neighbors. Then all routes will be available in the BGP table. And using the best route, that attributes I told, no, AS path. Using the AS path, it will select the best route, put it in the routing table. So total, three tables are there. Okay. Now ask me any questions in this, then I'll show you the lab for this. You have any questions? Otherwise, give yes, I'll show you the lab. So BGP maintains three tables. Peer table, BGP table, routing table. Let us start one by one. Let me write on that. It maintains three tables. What are they? BGP tables. First is peer table. What is peer table? Neighbors. Who are my neighbors? What is the command to see peer table? The command is show IP BGP summary. It will show me who is my near peers. Second table is BGP table. This is to tell you all routes. All routes will be there in the whatever received from the peers. All routes will be there in the neighbor table. What is the command to see that? Show IP BGP. Yes, the last one is, you know, routing table. The command is IP route. We have only best route. So these are the three commands, and I'll write down to establish peer also. I'll write down all the command syntax. I'll write down to establish peers. What is the command? Okay, establish peers and to advertise routes. What is the command? Advertise route is to advertise. And this so the command is network command. That's it. This is the command. Network address mask subnet mask. Here the command is network address. Ask, then put. Mask. Subnet mask. Yeah, this is the command, and so when you first what you do, we create the peer table, peers, neighbors. Once you become the neighbor, then you just advertise the route, whatever routes you want to advertise. Then you can see three tables here. Now what I'm going to do, I am going to show you a real BGP router. Instead of doing GNS3, you can do GNS3 also, but it will not show real router, no? Like, I like to show you real router. So what we will do, we'll just go to one lab. Let me see what is available for me. Routing and switching. Yes, available. I got it. Okay, now what I will do, I will just keep a SSH, not SSH, telnet enough. But what is the port number for telnet? Anybody? Port number? Help. 25. No, wrong answer. Shokumar also wrong. Correct. Kausia is correct. Okay, let us do that. Let me copy this domain name. Sorry. Copy. Then put in this here. Number 23. Save as what is this? R R news. Okay, now I'm inside the BGP, real BGP router. I'm going to give first show IP BGP summary. Now this will show me my peers, peer cable. I think so. Still it is finding out. Yeah, now I got it. Now see here, this guy, neighbors, who are my neighbors, what is the version, what is the AS number, and what is the, how many messages received, send, tabular version, in queue, out queue, queuing also they showed, and how many days it is up. 21 weeks, 4 days it is active. My neighbor is active. Good. So this is the details we have. Then this my neighbors I have. Good. This router is having. Next, I'm going to see the routes. This is, remember, this is I'm seeing internet. So in internet, what all the routes are there, it will be visible in this router. Enter. Now the internet starts from 1.network. Okay, internet starts from 1.network. To go to 1.0.0.network, this router has so many routes to reach that. In that best route is this arrow mark, can you see, greater than symbol? This is the best route. Now, this is the AS path. I told you, right? First to go to this autonomous system, then it go to this autonomous system. Then I means IGP. Maybe RIP, EAGR, OSPF. This is IGP. So this is the different autonomous. This is the path, AS path. Mention here path, see? So AS path. So spacebar 1.0, 1.0.4.0, spacebar 5.0, like this, it keeps on going. You can keep on pressing and seeing. You keep on going. Next, I'm pressing escape. Then I'm going to finally show you IP routing table. So IP route. In IP route, we'll see only the best route. Now, 1.0.0, what is the best route? 202. So we'll go back to 1.0 network. We will see that. 202, this is the best, right? Yeah, 202, 232, 202, this is the best route. Now see here, 202, 232, 202. So all, only the best route will come to routing table. So this is starting from 1.network. So spacebar, it keeps on going. I mean 1.network, it will go like this up to 223. Remember, it will go up to 223. All the routes, internet routes will be available in the router. This is BGP. So you're able to understand what is BGP now? Any questions, any doubts, you can ask me. This is the last topic. We have finished CCNA routing and switching. Good. Any other questions? So Kumar, anyone? So now we have just touched the introduction. As I told you, we have just touched all the topics as an introduction only. We are not going very deeper. So that is covered in CCNP, CCIE levels. But this is the CCNA. What they are trying to do is they just want to give you all openers, eye openers like that. They are touching all the topics. Okay, so we will wind up with this today. And thank you for attending my class, CCNA class. I'll appreciate your participations. Thanks. I like to have your feedbacks. You can send me in Skype or mail or whatever you like. You can just send me a feedback so for the course, how it was. Okay. That will help me to develop my teaching methodologies. Okay, So thank you everyone. Good night. We'll see you on if you have any doubts, any questions, any doubts is there, please feel free to send me email. Ask me at any time. If I'm in class or if I'm traveling somewhere, I'll answer you whenever I'm free. Okay? Please, you know my email ID, right? Kumar6009. You can send me emails. Okay? I appreciate sending in emails. I like to have emails with Skype, or if you have any doubts in Packet Tracer, you create a Packet Tracer. Send me the Packet Tracer file. With the file you send me, I will troubleshoot and give back to you. Okay? Please send me any doubts, any questions. Please call. Feel free to message me or call me. Call me, I don't like, because I don't be busy in touching the calls. You message me, best is mail. Okay, so take care, bye.